Welcome to Digital Nation, the show that brings you the very best of local TV. This week we travel by train into Glasgow's long-forgotten past. We check out the Cambridge exhibition of a famous South Pole expedition. We join Liverpool in their quest to discover the next British astronaut. And we meet the current Solent stars of the Quidditch Arena. Now, are you living local? Then let us know what you think by using the hashtag DigitalNation. Created by the architects of the iconic London Eye, the new I360 tower in Brighton will become the world's tallest vertical cable car. Here we meet the I360 team as the tower becomes the tallest in Sussex and reaches its full height of 162 metres. A top day for all concerned.
During the design stage, the I360 engineers had to consider one big problem. How do you build a 162-metre tower using a crane alone? The answer was to use another, more innovative method. The jacking tower is a temporary steel frame that fits around the I360 tower. Cable jacking systems inside are attached to a 16-ton steel collar which fits around the can. Four strand jacks, each with a lifting capacity of 450 tons, then gradually lift or jack up the can, as well as everything above it. This makes space for a new section of the tower to be slid underneath using the skid track. Cans 1 to 3 are topped with cans 14 to 17. The jacking collar fits around can 14, allowing us to lift the top cans. Can 3 is then removed to make space for can 13 to be slotted in. Once the cans are bolted into place, the collar moves down and the process begins again.
It is an exceptionally tall, thin tower that really is on the sort of leading edge of design of very tall, thin structures. The tower is about 4 metres in diameter and 162 metres tall.
It's been absolutely fantastic to come up on the jacking tower today. The views are just beautiful, and it's amazing to think that we're only 60 metres high and eventually you'll be able to glide up to 138 metres on the I360. Can't wait to see the view then.
It's the last jacking operation that we're about to do today. We've been battling the weather in the past week or two. We've carried out 8 jacking operations and now this is the 9th and final one. Although the tower is going to be at full height tonight, there's still a long way to go, but a big milestone for the project.
Fantastic. I mean, it's a very proud day, I think, for the entire team today to see, what we've all been working on for, up 10 years now. And it's remarkable, and it's gone up in only 10 weeks.
Brighton's an iconic place, and this just adds one more element to Brighton, and it brings us neatly into the 21st century.
Next, we travel to Preston to check out the annual Navratri celebrations. The traditional Hindu festival, symbolising good triumphing over evil, lasts 9 nights and features a lot of dancing. Here's That's Lancashire to tell us more.
The Gujarat Hindu Society is a place of celebration and worship for the Hindu community in Lancashire.
This is the epic centre for Hindus in the whole of Lancashire. We cater for all the Hindus. We've got Goddess Amba, Rama, Krishna, Lord Shiva, Ganesh, and Hanuman. Navratra is a very special festival for all Hindus universally.
Through this celebration, Goddess Durga will be worshipped in her 9 forms as a sign of appreciation and love. The 8th day is the most important as hundreds of Hindus come to the temple to pray through the art of dancing.
It's a religious celebration of dance and music. And especially at Gujarat Hindu Society, we have a fantastic turnout of people and women can portray their aesthetic as well as their religious side. Garba and Ras are the folk dance forms from Gujarat. And they are very popular world over because it's got a pattern and it's got a religious implication to it.
This festival will continue throughout the week as men and women dress up in traditional outfits to dance the night away on Gujarati folk music.
To Nottingham now to meet Aidan Lovelace. an early engineer who wrote the first computer program. That was before computers even existed. She also happened to be Lord Byron's daughter. So put away your hedonism textbooks and study the poetry of maths.
She's less famous than her Lothario father, whose ancestral home is here in Notts, but it's hoped her legacy will inspire a generation of new female scientists, engineers and mathematicians. Byron won hearts with his poetry. But more than 160 years since she died, his daughter Ada Lovelace is still winning over minds with her maths.
She really was massively ahead of her time. So she works together with a person called Charles Babbage to develop the ideas of computers and computer programs 100 years before Alan Turing really kind of brought this into physical reality. She faced an awful lot of pressure from society to get her not to do this thing. It was not something that women did at this point.
Lovelace barely knew her famous father. Her parents split when Ada was just 5 weeks old. Historians say her mother encouraged her to study maths to stop her going down the artistic, perhaps more hedonistic route taken by Byron. A national campaign is highlighting Lovelace's work to encourage women to work as scientists, engineers, and mathematicians.
Ada Lovelace wrote the world's first computer program, and very few people actually know who she even was. So about half of the GCSE physics entrants in the UK are women. However, it drops and drops and drops as you go through from A-levels to degree level through to working in the engineering profession. And that's a number that stubbornly hasn't moved very much over the last 10 years. And I want women not to face the same situation I did when I was an undergraduate, where I was very, very much in the minority.
Lovelace died when she was just 36, the same age as Byron was when he passed away. Buried in the family vault at St Mary Magdalene Church in Hucknall, she was laid to rest next to her father, closer than they'd been for much of their lives.
London Live recently attended a special ceremony at the Museum of the Order of St John. The event was held to honour the lives of organ donors and discover how the relatives feel about living with the impact of their loved ones' life-saving legacies.
It's a remarkable gift for anyone to give. It's something which can save up to 9 lives. And although many of us think that we could be an organ donor when we're well and fit and healthy, we know that when it comes to the day when your loved one is dying, agreeing to support their wish to be organ donors can be really tough for people. We want to make sure that all of our organ donors are honoured and that their families know how much we appreciate the gift that they have given, and so that their memory lives on in this award.
My wife has passed away, but when I remember that she donated some of her organ, I feel she's still alive. I try to periodically read the letter to know who I've benefited, and the organ is still there, and they are alive. Then when they are alive, she's alive too. One that caught my attention the most was the 7-year-old boy that benefited of her heart. And even when we don't even know them, it was an honour to see that a 7-year-old boy still have future ahead of him.
Certainly very proud, and I think it's one good thing that's come out of it, and I've been probably quietly looking forward to the day, to be honest with you, as in it's certainly a mark, and I think it's something, you know, Susan should be proud of. One of the recipients sent a letter and said it had changed his life, which is quite something, really.
To begin with, when people come along to start the ceremony, they are quite nervous. But actually afterwards, they say it helped in the bereavement process. And the opportunity to talk and share with families in similar positions has been very much welcomed. We would like people who have registered their wish for their organs to be used to talk to their families and to make it something that isn't taboo, but actually is a very important part of life.
Digital Nation has taken you to all parts of the UK, including Scotland, Northern Ireland, England, Wales, and beyond. So where's left for us to visit? Well, space, obviously. In this clip, Bay TV Liverpool shows us a brand new exhibition encouraging a new generation of British astronauts.
We're here in the World Museum in Liverpool for Destination Space, a brand new exhibition aiming to equip children with everything they need to be Britain's next top astronaut.
It was really cool because, like, you can just, like, it's like a robot, kind of, just way cooler. We'd have to, like, memorise which controls which, so I don't think I'd be able to do that.
And what did you think of the meteorite?
It was really, really heavy for such, like, a small thing. Because you just think it's going to be, like, a normal thing, and then you're like, yeah.
Would you like to go into space at all?
I'd like to for some of it, because I love the picture up there, so I'd really want to see that, but then it'd be quite scary as well.
This is just one part of the outside of the spacesuit. There's actually three layers they'll wear, and this has been very hot to wear all day, especially when you've got the hood, the hat part, the helmet on. Of course, it's really hot. You've got all your breath. I mean, it's cool material. Now, the spacemen, they have to wear it the whole time, just in case there's an emergency. So imagine that, three hours, maybe 3 days. I can get out, so I can't imagine having to last much longer than a 3 hours without being able to escape. This is the badge. This is the Principia badge that was designed by Blue Peter Viewer. It has an Isaac Newton's apple because it's Principia for Isaac Newton, right? And we have a wonderful ESA, European Space Agency badge. And of course, the Union flag because it's a British astronaut going to space.
That's it for part one. But before we leave you, it's quiz time. Which city's famous cranes are called Samson and Goliath? Is it A, Liverpool? B, Southampton? Or C, Belfast? Join us after the break for the answer. Welcome back to Digital Nation. Before the break, we asked you, which city's famous cranes are called Samson and Goliath? And the answer is C, Belfast. Samson and Goliath are the twin shipbuilding cranes located at Queen's Island, which dominate the Belfast skyline. Next up, following the launch of the Grimsby and Cleethorpes edition of Monopoly, who should win this very special copy of the board game? Only the biggest Grimsby fan ever, an inspiring young fundraiser and poet George Kavanagh talking to Emma Lingard at Estrey TV.
And joining me now is one of the special guests of VIP, very special player, and that's George Kavanagh. George, we saw you on there collecting your board.
Yes, we did, and this is the very board
that's
here.
That's the board.
Now, this is the Grimsby and Cleethorpes Monopoly, and I'm so proud to own this board.
Are you?
And I've also got another board.
I'll say, how come you've got two?
Well, the thing is, yeah. I've technically got three. There's one in the car waiting for me and Mum.
Right.
You see, I've got that one, which I'm never going to open. I've got this one that I'm going to get a photo frame from. Then I've got another one that I'm going to actually play with.
You've got some signatures on here then. Who
yes,
have you
I
made
have.
Sign this board today?
Well, basically, we people who have put all the effort in making this Monopoly board. There's quite a few signatures there.
And you're going to get this framed?
Yes, I am.
Now, I can tell you were very excited today. Did you enjoy it this morning?
I absolutely loved it. It was absolutely fantastic. Do you know exactly how I won that Monopoly board?
No, go and tell us.
I made a poem just explaining that how I've just done nothing but fundraise ever since my dad passed away. And I've been fundraising for a charity very close to my heart, which is St Andrews. And using that poem,
yeah,
I won myself a little Monopoly board, so
you,
I'm
you
really
did extremely
myself.
Well, didn't you, for that?
I sure did.
Now, I missed this, but did you actually get to play the first game?
Yes, I did. As a matter of fact, we all went onto the Ross Tiger in Grimsby,
yeah,
an old fishing boat, and we played it in the captain's cabin. But it was an amazing day that I will never forget. Grimsby has a bit of a bad reputation at the moment, but that board there just gives you an idea if you are a bit like that about Grimsby. It just lets you know that Grimsby is an amazing town.
Yes.
And although some people are umming and ahhing about it after Skint on Channel 4,
yeah,
and Grimsby with the film in Essex, stupid Essex, making Grimsby look a shame, it is an amazing town, and that's what not everyone realises. And I'm not being funny. That Monopoly board shows us how amazing the town is.
But as well as being an ambassador for the hospice, you should be an ambassador for Grimsby, because you did fabulous.
All aboard, it's time to head to Glasgow Central Station for a special treat. Although over 30 million passengers use the station every year, very few get to see the hidden treasure underground. So let's join STV Glasgow for a glimpse into transport's past.
Glasgow Central Station is one of the biggest and busiest railway stations in Britain. We have, on average, well over 1,200 train movements per day coming in and out of Glasgow Central Station. As well as that, we have well over 106,000 passengers per day. That's approximately 34 million people per year. Scotland's population is just over 5,300,000. This illustrates to me how big and how busy Glasgow Central Station really is. Given that Glasgow Central Station is one of the biggest and busiest out with the London stations, well over 1,200 train movements per day coming in and departing from Glasgow Central Station. Think of the constant pounding on the superstructure of these girders here. Of the original skeleton of this station, absolutely nothing has moved. A testament to Victorian engineering. We'll now make our way down to Glasgow's best kept secret, the Victorian platforms. This was closed in 1964 as part of Dr. Beeching's savage cuts in Britain's railways. The tracks were ripped up in 1964, this area was blocked up and completely forgotten about. It's incredible for us to imagine that hundreds of people use this platform on a daily basis. And here comes the train now, travelling from Newton through to Balquhir. Think next time you come to Glasgow Central Station, folks, what lies beneath your feet down here in these vaults. Glasgow Central Station, Glasgow's best kept secret.
When it comes to ingenuity and innovation, you just can't beat this creative kingdom we call home.
So you think that Hollywood is the home of cinema? Come off it! If you're after the real birthplace of the silver screen, look no further than Brighton. While Tinseltown was still a village, Brighton was setting the pace. First use of special effects? Brighton. First female filmmaker? Brighton. First ever book adaptation? Brighton. First use of fancy montage effects? Brighton. First ever war cameraman? Brighton. First ever colour film? Brighton. And first ever blue movie? Brighton. Because when it comes to innovation, creativity, and keeping it real to real, in Brighton Brill.
Celebrating the 100th anniversary of one of the UK's most famous explorers, Cambridge TV takes us on a journey to find out more about Sir Ernest Shackleton's South Pole expedition. Surviving members of his family believe it was his legendary leadership skills that led to his crew's survival.
The results of the British Antarctic Expedition of 1907 under my command are as follows. We reached a point within 97 geographical miles of the South Pole, the only thing that stopped us from reaching the actual point was the lack of 50 pounds of food.
It has been 100 years since Sir Ernest Shackleton's ill-fated expedition to the Antarctic, and to mark the occasion, the Polar Museum have launched an exhibition entitled By Endurance We Conquer, Shackleton and His Men.
I think one of the purposes of these anniversaries is to make a new generation of people aware, or to remind them of the exploits of these people. Recently, we've heard about a spacecraft going past Pluto, which is the edge of our solar system. I think it's quite legitimate to compare that exercise today with people going to the South Pole 100 years ago. There was no satellites, there was no communication with, for years. Shackleton, on the Endurance expedition, together with his men, didn't see a soul outside their own party for just about 3 years. In fact, he writes very interestingly and movingly in his diary as he and two companions are finally crossing the mountains of South Georgia to raise the alarm and to begin the rescue. He hears the siren from the whaling station on South Georgia, and that, he notes in his diary afterwards, is the first human sound apart from our own voices that we've heard for 3 years.
There was a lack of interest for quite a few years, but it revived in the 1990s, and now, just to take myself as an example, I go around the world talking about him. I've been to the Antarctic 5 times. This year alone I was in America, or Australia, Norway, and the interest builds for one reason: his leadership, the way he led his men, which is quite modern for an explorer of a century ago. He took great trouble to get to know his men, which wasn't typical, particularly in the era when there's a huge gap in education between the leaders and the led. It's really the leadership skills that make him immortal.
The exhibition is now open and will allow people to come and learn the story of the ship Endurance and Sir Ernest Shackleton, the explorer who never gave up on his men.
Which sport is played on broomsticks where the aim of the game is to catch the golden snitch? Well, that Solent is about to show us how this strange sport, loved by Harry Potter fans, has become an international phenomenon with its own worldwide leagues.
There are 7 players on each side, and it is based on the Harry Potter books, so there is 1 keeper and 3 chasers who use the quaffle, which in our case is a volleyball, to score hoops. Each hoop's worth 10 points. There are 2 beaters on each team, and they use the bludgers, which basically work as obstacles. So if you're hit by a bludger, then you have to dismount from your broom, run back to your own hoops, tap back in, and then carry on again. And there's also 1 seeker whose goal is to catch the golden snitch. It's a full contact sport. Full contact mixed gender is how it's described. So, I mean, it's one-armed tackles because one hand is holding onto your broom. That does mean that there is potential for injury, especially on hard ground like we have today. It's the same as rugby tackles, so it is full contact. In March, we went to Nottingham and we came away as the British Quidditch champions, which was an absolutely amazing achievement, having finished 4th at the previous cup about 18 months before. And just at the weekend, we finished joint 3rd at the European Quidditch Championships.
So, if you're considering getting active, looking for a new hobby, and see yourself as a bit of a budding beater, why not give Quidditch a try? You don't need to be magic to play this game.
That's it for this week's Best of Local. If you've enjoyed the show, then don't forget you can catch up on previous episodes by visiting bbc.co.uk/digitalnation. So until next week, goodbye.